Welcome to Faith Works Live. Here's your host, Rebecca Haynie.
It's a beautiful day in the neighborhood. This is Faith Works Live, and I'm glad you're here. And I'm glad to be here with you talking about the main thing here on Faith Works Live and how to make the main thing in our lives. I don't know if anybody still says that, but like I'm stuck in the 90s and I'm okay with it. It is a gorgeous day and election season is upon us. This is my favorite time of year. Politics notwithstanding, it's just a gorgeous time to be in the Midwest and enjoying all the full pantheon of gorgeous colors and just the artwork of our creators on full display. But with that comes things like elections. And how do we stay informed and how do we vote biblically? I've been hearing an awful lot and I've been contributing an awful lot to those conversations about presidential politics lately. And in the First in the Nation caucus state, that's our bread and butter. We do it so you don't have to, America. You're welcome. But we also have an important election coming up this November. And that includes, I would say, even more important for our daily lives, things like city council members, school board members. You probably have different county officials, even judges that are up for retention, sheriffs that can be up for election in your area. And I don't want that to get lost in the shuffle. I think that's very important for Christians to engage biblically with this particular election. It just, you know, sometimes doesn't have the drama or people don't have the publicity of what's happening coming up here in 2023. So to help us stay informed and to engage well is one of our favorite people. Samantha Fett is on the line with us from Moms for Liberty. Samantha, it's great to have you back.
It's so great to be here. I always love being on your show and contributing in any way I can.
Of course. Well, you're a powerful voice for liberty. And we were talking last time we were discussing mostly about a kind of a statewide look at the impact of certain laws that were enacted by our legislature last session. And that's been the subject of much contention, especially as regards school board elections. So let's put some of those pieces together and talk about why this election matters for liberty and for the average Iowa family.
Well, just being a Moms for Liberty member in my area, Warren County, we are looking at school board elections, but that's not just in our area. Like you mentioned, statewide school boards are seeing lots of candidates come forward and it's time to pay attention. One of the things that's really important is what the state legislature has done in the last session is pass some of these laws that maybe you've heard of it, this funny narrative of book banning. Well, what they're doing now is pushing that narrative on a lot of our school board candidates that are ready to stand up for kids or focus on education. And so we're seeing a lot of pressure in these school board elections, a lot of social issues. And so it's getting really interesting. And we need to encourage and uplift anyone that's running for school board right now that is a Christian conservative. They are being hammered so heavily. And a lot of these people are not used to that. They're not heavily involved in politics. They care about education and they're just ready to stand up in their community. And when you have these school board elections, it's very personal. You know, it's your neighbor. It's the people you go to school with. Your kids play sports with them. And so to have this pushback from people that you know is really hard for a lot of people to handle. And so we just need to make sure that we encourage them to keep pushing forward, to stand for liberty, to stand for Christian values. And most importantly, making sure that our children receive the best education possible in these public school districts. As we know, the left is trying to indoctrinate them with all these crazy things. And those that stand up against it, and saying, hey, wait a minute, let's take a look at this, are getting so much hate pushed their way. Yeah. So right now, our focus locally has been encouraging those candidates, helping them navigate through a lot of that false narrative that they don't care about children. We have endorsed several candidates in the state. Moms for Liberty has endorsed 13 candidates. And so with that endorsement, it's a target, right? We were put on a hate group list. I can't even remember why, right? It obviously not true. So these candidates are getting the heat from that as well. But people that understand the mission and the vision of Moms for Liberty know that that's simply not true. They are focused solely on education and making sure children receive the best education possible.
Well, and you mentioned something that's so difficult. So I've been encouraging good, honest, you know, God-fearing people to run for office. When people would ask me for years in political advocacy, they're like, well, what do I do to make a difference? And I said, if you don't see anybody good on your ballot, you need to run. Maybe God's calling you to run and step in and just say, you know, by telling the truth, by standing for American values, by standing up for the Declaration, the Constitution, everything we were founded on, and knowing the difference between truth and lie and being willing to stand for truth, that should be enough. And, oh, you know, sweet summer child that I was way back in the day, I've seen that. I've seen good people step forward, and I'm so proud of them. I truly am. I joke that I love my family too much to run for office because it's just mudslinging. And it's not like this is the first generation that's ever come up with a political insult, but it is so bad now where people just lie with impunity. They don't take the time to even remotely make it, you know, believable. They'll just call you every name in the book just because they disagree with you about maybe one policy. They'll say, if you don't agree with me that a student should be allowed to wear a cat costume and use a litter box in a classroom, well, then you're basically a Nazi. You're basically a fascist. And like the rhetoric is so extreme that there are so many, you know, good people that are scared to confront that, or they'll step into those waters and then they're facing this just over tidal wave, this barrage of personal attacks against them from people that they, you know, thought were their friends and neighbors up until 5 minutes ago. And that is really hard to withstand. And I say all that because you're involved in the political fray. You've stepped in as a candidate in the primary for state house. So next time around, not this, yes. You're not on this ballot, but next time around. And you've gotten a fair taste of all of that. And so I'd love to hear your thoughts on what it's like to combat that, dealing with that, and how to respond to the haters we're never going to cower in fear. We're going to stand up for the truth. So how do we respond to those attempts to attack and intimidate?
Well, I'll back up even further. I was a school board member in my area and then lost my re-election campaign because of the book issue. And so we were in the midst of coming off COVID. And obviously I was someone that said, no masks, please. And so right away I was a target anyway. But besides that, the book issue had come up right during the re-election campaign. And so it was a really fascinating time for our family to experience this barrage of hatred that came our way, of being called a racist and a homophobe and a transphobic and a lot of different names that I've never really seen used in a full sentence towards a person. So I was involved because I loved education and I wanted to see things improve. And then I got thrust into this atmosphere of constant negativity. So you learn how to be on the defense all of the time. And so, you know, I kind of want to say maybe I was a little naive and in dealing with that, but I think it was a good experience for me to go through. So I'm prepared for running for House. But in addition to that, helping and mentoring some of the new school board candidates that are running, you know, I get calls from them saying, hey, they said this about me, what should I do? And, you know, part of it is, well, just ignore it. It's no big deal. But they're psychologically injured, I guess, or hurt because these are their neighbors calling them names and they don't know how to deal with it. So I feel like my skin has been thickened. I don't know how do I say that? My skin has been toughened. Unfortunately, I've armored up. Yes. I often say, you know what, they hated me before they even knew me. And if they can call me a name that I haven't been called yet, then I'm going to give them a gold star because I've heard it all. And so, but that's a process to get through. Yeah. And so one of the biggest pushbacks that we see and what the left loves to tell us is, how are you going to protect the LGBTQ community with policies? Mm-hmm. And as a school board member and then helping some of these candidates navigate that question, we're not protecting a specific community members. Our policies, the policies in place in schools protect all children from all bullying. Those policies are in place. So the simple answer to that is, I will hold my administration accountable to following the policies that the school board has enacted, period. And once you start saying things like that, it shuts that narrative down, because you are no longer giving them the fuel to call you a racist or a homophobe. You are simply a person that enacts a policy. So once we get, because a lot of people want to say, well, that's not, I love all people, you know, and going down this path of, we don't need to defend that. We, from a school board perspective, you're there to enact policy. So the other piece of it is parental involvement. A lot of talk about, you know, how do we handle mental health in schools? That's a popular question right now in these forums for these school board candidates. And again, parental involvement for any child that's having any issue on any level, that's how we partner and we foster this, I don't know, maybe I should use the left term of inclusion. We foster that inclusion of both the parents and the administrator. I mean, I think that's a great idea, right? So trying to use maybe some of their language, I don't want to say against them, but making them understand that maybe some of their premises are ridiculous and people that are running for a school board actually do care about kids. So, That's my experience from beginning to end here at this point. And honestly, I'm so excited for the school board elections to be done. But we have so much work. This is a time right now where we do not sleep. We are writing postcards. We were door knocking, signs. I mean, it's kind of crazy. So I'll be excited when November 7th arrives.
As you're out canvassing and encouraging people to vote, is this on people's minds? I get the feeling that it's sort of in the back burner. Most off-year elections have been, you know, since before I even came on the scene. I've seen a lot of renewed interest in the local offices, things like school boards over the last few years that has become increasingly important. I am blown away by the interest in just our small town. Of the people that listen know that we just live in, like, essentially Mayberry is where we live in Iowa. It's a beautiful community called Ogden. A couple thousand people. We all, you know, seem to get along and the golden rule is still in place. It's a wonderful, wonderful place. But there have been some concerns in our schools as well. We're not immune into what's going on in the rest of the world and the rest of the state. And I think that really, there have been a few incidents that woke people up here in our community. And there has been such renewed interest that now we have a school board of three people and there are eight candidates running that I know of. And that is, it's kind of crazy to see. In a way, it's wonderful to see that level of civic engagement, but it also makes it a little more difficult for the voters because just kind of like as the flowers all died down, these signs for school boards started to pop up in our front yards. And I don't know half the people that are running. And so I need to know and get more informed. That can be difficult in a local election if you don't happen to personally know that person. And we're kind of new to the community. So I am having to practice what I preach by doing some research on who these candidates are so that I can be an informed voter. And it's a kind of an awesome experience.
Well, you're not alone. I mean, there's lots of people in many different communities that feel the same and they want to do the research. Are they going to take the time? Number one. But number two, if those candidates are outdoor knocking and talking about who they are, then those people that, you know, have took a minute to talk to them are going to feel more engaged to vote. Now, I will say in door knocking experience for some of these candidates, when you do introduce them, one of their first questions is, well, are they for book banning? That comes from, I don't know, local news media recording, you know, talking more about book bans, which just isn't true. I mean, the word ban is overused in the wrong way. And I think there was just a hearing in D.C. yesterday about book banning. And a lot of people were like, banning means it's out of circulation completely. So if you're saying that it's removed from school library and that's being banned, that's a misuse of the word. So anyway, a lot of those people that you do engage with at the doors are asking about that because that's what they think they should be asking. And they also then you start this conversation of, well, it's not really a ban. These are sexually explicit books. And then we go down this path of education, educating these voters of, oh, well, I didn't realize that. Or saying, well, I don't believe any book should be banned. And then all of a sudden, the line is drawn in the sand. Mm-hmm. And we've come to a partisan discussion in a nonpartisan race. And I think that is the challenge with some of these school board elections. They are nonpartisan. And so when these candidates take this on, it's really hard for them to navigate in that space, because they can't necessarily, you know, come out and be like, you know, things that are really easy in a partisan race. I'm mm-hmm. pro-life, right? Yeah. And that's pretty, you know, that's pretty, there's no really discussion around that, right? But in the school board races, it's like, well, you know, I'm here for education and I don't think kids should have sexually explicit material. Well, mm-hmm. that has turned into a Republican or a conservative viewpoint. And so immediately some of these people will shut down or give you pushback. And that's where a lot of that negativity comes from.
Yeah.
So, you know, doing your own research and looking up these candidates is so important. And, you know, we tell our candidates on their Facebook page to put out, you know, as much information about them as possible. Now, the left is going to take that and say, well, they hate public education. They stand for school choice, you know. And so, again, another partisan topic comes into that. You know, you could still be a school board member of a public school system and support school choice.
Yes.
Because you believe children should be able to go to any school that's going to help them thrive, period. So that's a long answer to your question, but the reality is do your research mm-hmm. and don't listen to the local news about the candidates. I don't know.
Yeah. Well, and that's a hard thing too, because those were the voices that we trusted to tell us what was going on. And now they're more involved and interested in introducing those ideas and controlling the public dialogue rather than giving us information and allowing us to speak freely. It really isn't so much a public square as it is this little 3x5 card of the Overton window that keeps shifting further and further left. Funny how that goes. But you're right. When people hear this idea about a book ban, that is intentionally incendiary language that is continually repeated by the media who want the outrage because they want eyeballs on their headlines. So this all cycles back around. And I can say that because I've been a part of it for so long. I've seen how the sausage is made, and it's not pretty. But then once those ideas are out there and they're introduced, a prepared candidate needs to have a good answer. And mm-hmm. and that's perfectly fair. If someone says, well, how come you're for banning books in the local libraries? I heard about that on my news, and that doesn't sound good. That sounds like Hitler. And I say, well, you know, Hitler and I, two different people, you know, could not be more opposed. Thank you for noticing. I'm your neighbor. I care about kids. I care about protecting all kids, exactly as you said. I want our schools to function well. I want our kids to know how to read. Absolutely. I'm not about banning books. Have you seen my library? You know, maybe that's just for the book nerds like me. I grew up in libraries. So the fact that this is like ground zero for the culture war is especially personal to me. That's just a Rebecca rant side note for another day. But the fact that they say we're for book banning, I'm like, no, maybe I'm just not for the sexually explicit instructions on mm-hmm. pornographic material, on specific acts, specific sexual acts to be performed by children on adults with illustrations. That is unacceptable. No child in grade school or middle school should have access to that kind of smut. I'm sorry. End of discussion. Mm-hmm. Like, that's not book banning. That's just parenting. That's just protecting kids. Any stranger introducing that type of information to my child in any type of environment should go to jail. That is not education. That is that is perversion. That is a crime. So if anyone's confused about that, there you go. That's where I stand. I'm not running for anything, but support my platform. But you have to be able to take that and say it maybe in a friendlier way with an average discussion. But that's really what we're talking about, in case anybody was confused. You have to be prepared to be clear and yet still be, well, the Christian phrase of like the last decade has been winsome. We need to be winsome with the way that we talk about it. And I think that we can do that, but we can't be afraid. And what you suggested, Samantha, is exactly right in terms of understanding the school board's role of administration. You don't have to go in there primed to be, you know, the ultimate culture warrior. You have to be willing to stand for the truth. And I think that can motivate for sure. But what you have to do is just be an effective administrator. You have to say, I know the law. I know what I know right from wrong. I care about kids and I want us to function effectively to protect kids from, you know, whatever that may be that is seeking to encroach. And we're going to abide by the law. We're going to function effectively. We're going to spend money responsibly. And we're going to have curriculum that both abides by the law and enhances children's education, that truly fosters a love of learning and the skills necessary for them to be good, solid, productive members of society. And we're going to work well with parents and with teachers alike. I mean, that seems like it should be a given. That seems like everybody should be able to support that. I'm sorry that it's gotten partisan. We're not the ones on the conservative side. I'll just speak for myself. We're not the ones that turned that fight partisan. We just wanted to, you know, be good friends and neighbors and be free. And you do your thing and I do mine. And, you know, and everybody wins. That's not the world in which we live. So to make the argument that you can function effectively, be an effective and law-abiding administrator that keeps everybody safe according to playing by the same rules. We're not going to let politics run away with the education system anymore. Common sense reigns here because we all care about kids. I think that's what a school board member needs to say.
Yeah, certainly. And that's a lot. If you look at some of the conservative candidates, literature, it's going to say, let's continue the legacy of our school district. Let's continue to hold, you know, our administrators accountable. Let, you know, all of these things that aren't partisan, but should be common sense of what a school board member does. And the way that the left, you know, sets themselves apart is, well, we're not for book bans and we're not going to file, you know, Senate file 496. We're going to try to file, you know, find holes in that. And then they get endorsed by, you know, the Democratic Party. We just got a flyer in Polk County where they endorsed all of these liberal candidates and listed their names and, you know, sent in an absentee ballot, you know, application with it. You know, so they're using party politics. They're using those strategies to try to get out the vote and, you know, draw the line and divide the school district even further. And that, I think, is what a lot of conservative candidates don't want that to happen. That shouldn't be happening. We should have people on the school boards that just truly care about the education. I mean, we have reading proficiencies that are low statewide, you know, and that's not getting a lot of attention. I would love for that to blow up in the media and at the doors when we're talking. Do you know what the reading level is and why is it so low? I would love for people to get excited about that, but it just gets overshadowed by some of these person politics that are a very small piece of what they'll be, these school board members will be dealing with on a monthly basis. So, you know, it's unfortunate and we just keep fighting. We keep sifting through that. You know, some of these town halls that are happening, we're hearing crazy questions like I mentioned earlier, Senate file 496 that defines books that can't be in the library that have sex acts in them, you know, and they're asking, how are you going to navigate that law to minimize the effect on children? What? How is that even a question? We follow the law. I'm not, as a school board member, going to be like, well, let's look through this and see how we can skirt it. Right. I mean, that's just a ridiculous premise. So those are the fights that we're up against. But again, encouraging these candidates to keep moving forward, keep fighting, because on the other end, they can really make a big difference in their local community.
And Samantha Fett is our excellent guest here on FaithWorks Live. We're talking about how to engage biblically in our upcoming elections. In particular, we're looking at the impact of school board and local officials, because those are who are on the ballot. They don't get as much drama or as much camera time, or do they? We can't forget about those elections. I've often said that there's a very powerful, like the extremely dedicated minority have their voices heard in some of these school board elections, special elections. It doesn't take much to make a big difference and to make a big impact because the turnout is typically lower. I have seen a lot of increased engagement over the last few years, which is exciting to me, and I'm glad to see that. But if it really historically and in a lot of communities here in our state, it could be the margin of just a few dozen votes or a couple hundred votes can make all the difference in the world to getting a good, solid, freedom loving, constitution respecting, parents' rights understanding and advocating quality administrator in our schools, as well as our other city and county local leaders. We need good, trustworthy people in those offices. So let's not forget that that's coming up. They're all on the ballot in November. But it can be more difficult, like you said, Samantha, to be informed if you don't know who's running. So we'll talk a little bit about how we can get active, get involved, practically speaking, and some more encouragement when we return. You're listening to Faith Works Live.
Hey, what's for dinner? If you're like me, I hear that 15 times a day. And fortunately, I have a plan. It's typically Onimus beef at our house. We are such big fans of Onimus beef at the Haynie home because it's just great quality beef. There's no steroids or antibiotics. It's naturally raised butcher beef. They sell by the quarter, the half, or the whole, and they support your local meat lockers, so they can help you get it processed in a way that works for you. In this economy, it's good to have affordable options for your meat. And if you're willing to make a good investment in your nutrition for a healthy menu plan, I highly recommend Onimus Beef. Contact Dave and Mary Lynn at onimusbeef.com. They welcome your questions. They'll help get you on the schedule. They have locker dates coming up. Don't wait. Secure your locker date today. Go to onimusbeef.com. That's onimusbeef.com. There's no better time than now to stand for life. And you can stand with Iowa's original pro-life organization, Pulse for Life. They're the longest standing nonprofit pro-life organization in Iowa, and they are dedicated to informing, educating, and inspiring a new generation to value the sanctity of all human life from fertilization until natural death. They serve at the State House. They educate in classrooms, at events. They proudly serve on the coalition of pro-life leaders. They are on the front lines of the battle against this throwaway culture of death that we see all around us, and we are winning ground. Hearts and minds are changing, and the pro-life movement is continuing to grow. And you can be a part of the exciting things that are happening right here in our own backyard at pulseforlife.org and get your finger on the pro-life pulse. Sign up for their newsletter, find ways that you can make a difference, and how you can change hearts and minds with their pro-life apologetics course, pulseforlife.org. In today's world, security has never been more vital. And at FaithWorks Live, we're proud to partner with Verigard Security. It's a professional physical security service, and they're really raising the bar in security and private investigations. Whether you need a team of professional officers to protect what you have worked hard to build, or their mobile security units for multiple properties or large locations, from business or corporate properties to your home or neighborhood. Perhaps you've got an event coming up. They secure quality security coverage for events large and small, because it's about peace of mind and protecting you, your family, your team, and your property. Settle for nothing less than the best when it comes to your security. You shouldn't have to compromise. When it comes to security, you can trust Verigard. Contact them today at verigard.us. That's V-A-R-A-Guard.us. For security service, you can trust Verigard. When a woman faces an unplanned pregnancy, every possible emotion goes through her head. Where can she go for help and for hope? She can go to InnerVisions. Here in our metro, we have two healthcare clinics where she will find hope and help. From free pregnancy testing and STD testing to free ultrasounds, InnerVisions serves women and men with STDs who find themselves in vulnerable situations. They're completely free of charge because of generous donations from folks like you. And their medical clinics help their patients get all the information that they deserve that empowers them to make life-affirming decisions. That's what they do at InnerVisions Healthcare Clinics right here in Des Moines. Learn more at innervisionshealthcare.org. That's innervisionshealthcare.org. And you can call 24 hours a day at 515-440-CARE. That's 515-440-2273.
Glad you're here. Pull up a chair. We're talking about elections, not the big like flashy presidential ones, but the one that's coming up first, which is our school board, local officials. There are some state races as well. I'm sure that, depending on the area in which you live, it's going to be different for you. But how do you know? You can actually get sample ballots. You can actually go to your county's auditor's office. You can go to your local, usually city hall, and find out who's on the ballot. The county clerk will be able to help you. So you go and you make friends with those fine people in the offices and go learn their names, learn who their grandkids are, and find a sample ballot. So it's great. Absentee ballots also available. Like you just mentioned, Samantha Fett is our esteemed guest, returning rock star that she is. She's with Moms for Liberty. She's also broaching the political dragon by running for state house. So she'll be involved in a primary, and that'll be a fun race next time around. So for now, she's advocating, she's equipping candidates that are running to really help make the difference in this, to turn the tide in this next generation, to stand for liberty, for freedom, for family, for parents' rights, and for the safety of kids, for actual education going on in schools. What a concept. It's a wonderful thing. And Samantha, it can be difficult to get a handle, like I said, on some of these local races. There's not always a lot of publicity. Sometimes you kind of forget about them. They fade into the background. My advice to people is usually to contact your local, your city hall, your county clerk's office, and your auditors. Your local election officials are going to know who's on your ballot. That's the only way that I know about some of these races. Like, there were a bunch of judicial retention elections last year, and nobody had any literature because they're not considered partisan races, but almost no groups had any information about these judges' records because, you know, they weren't really endorsing. So that was difficult. As somebody who strives to be informed, I don't want to vote unless I know for sure that I can, you know, fully support this person. I believe I'm accountable, heavenly, accountable to God for my vote in the same way I am for my money or, you know, the other decisions I make. So I want to make a good choice. What are some other ways? You mentioned even just reaching out to meet the people that are on the ballot. If they're in your community, that might be a great idea.
Yeah. I mean, if you don't know who's running in your school district, you can always contact the school district as well. And they can give you a list of those who file paperwork. I mean, and that's the first step. If for whatever reason, your area doesn't have this crazy school board elections going on where you're going to see signs all over anyway. So you're kind of forced to pay attention. You're like, oh, there's an election coming up, if you're not always engaged. But, you know, a lot of people ask, how can I get involved? You know, what can I do to make a difference? And I know probably a lot of your listeners ask that question often because, you know, they see a lot of injustices happening. And so the biggest thing is to get out to vote and vote for these people, vote for the conservatives, vote for the people that stand for liberty. You can vote early. Early voting started October 18th. But how do we get information about them? So there's lots of different options you can do. I mean, you can reach out to your local Moms for Liberty chapter and ask. And if you don't have one, then you can, like you said, do some research on them. Most of the time, this school board election, because of the world we live in right now, has become extremely, over the top, or, you know, these school board candidates are raising money like crazy because they need to get their name out there. So you're going to be able to find them if you can just Google their name or find them on Facebook. And, you know, a lot of them have websites now. I mean, this is like a full-fledged state campaign that these people are running just in their local district. So I don't think it's going to be that hard for people that care, that are engaged and want to find out more information, for them to figure out exactly who's running. A lot of these chamber of commerce are in the areas are doing these town halls. So if you follow that on Facebook at all, they should have some information as well. So it's really just about the person getting civically engaged and understanding the importance of school boards and how important they are right now. They've always been important, but with the narrative that's being pushed to these children, it's even more important. You know, I actually hate when politicians say this is the most important election of your lifetime, right? I mean, I feel like I hear that all of the time.
Just like the last one.
The reality is every year it's just as important as it was last year. And it just becomes so important. So I think the moral of the story is it's always important. It's always this like thin thread that we have to vote. So I'm trying to create a sense of urgency for those listening that they need to go figure out who the right candidates are for their community to represent their school districts.
Yeah. And I appreciate that these offices have historically been a nonpartisan or sort of a parapartisan, metapartisan. There we go. That makes my English professor happy. The trouble, though, with that is that it seems like nothing in our lives is nonpartisan anymore. It's all been politicized. And in order to back up out of that, I think there does need to be consensus that's built. We need to find common ground with our friends and neighbors who maybe they vote for a different presidential candidate than we do, but we all care on a community level. We all care about our kids. And, if we can find ways that we have that common ground with one another, that's going to be, I think, what saves this country, quite frankly. It's going to be a revival on a spiritual level, and it's going to be remembering that your neighbor is not your enemy, and to learn to love your neighbor, even if they were the ones that insulted you, you know, just to be able to say, forgive them, Lord, they know not what they do. Help me to understand, help me to connect with that person. And so that would be my question to you is if you're seeing ways or particular issues or areas of agreement that we can sort of start to build or maybe rediscover some of that common ground again. If somebody's coming at you in an insulting way, you know, maybe that's a difficult place it would require some diffusion of potential bombs first. But what are some things that where we can maybe build common ground like you were talking about?
Well, two things. Number one, with the school choice bill that's passed, you know, a lot of public school districts are worried that they're, you know, everyone's going to leave the school. And so I think the common ground now is we need to make sure that our district is delivering what it needs to the customers. And the customers are the taxpayers and also those people that have children in the district. So understanding that the messaging and the communication to the district needs to be effective. And it's an important piece. So I think that everyone agrees with that. Everyone wants to know, why should I choose this district to educate my children? So destination districts are kind of I don't want to say nonpartisan, but kind of everyone agrees with that. And I mean, if you think about it, you know, when you're a young family and you're buying a home, you're like, well, let's look into the school district before we move there, right? I mean, this is not a new idea. Mm-hmm. So that's definitely a piece that could be nonpartisan or everyone can agree with that. And then the other thing is literally just the education test scores and the education level. I think one of the things that we hear a lot about is how do we equip our youth to be good members of the society after they graduate? They're either career ready or they're college ready. Right now, Iowa ranks 44th in the country for career and college ready students.
Wow.
So I think that is unacceptable, no matter what your politics are. Right. So it's really important to point those types of things out because then you understand where the priorities need to lie. We need to stop talking about our emotional health at school. We need to start focusing on real education that's going to, like I said, equip these kids. I mean, I just saw a story yesterday about financial literacy and how I think there's 9 states in the country that have filed a law that says it's required to take financial literacy before you graduate. Now, this seems very, isn't that what they're learning in school? Well, apparently not. So those are the types of things that can be agreed on by myself and my neighbor, right? Regardless of the politics, like I said before, how do we equip these kids to be a good member of society and be ready to work? I mean, there's also a lot of talk about the trades. How do we, you know, not every child wants to go to college or wants or even knows what they want to do after high school graduation. So introducing them in a different way to the trades, celebrating that, you know, as far as, you know, right now you have like college signing days for sports, which is great. These kids have worked so hard their whole life in a sport. Now they're getting a scholarship and they, you know, there's a signing, the parents come, you know, and it's this big celebration. And I think that's wonderful. But what about the kids that aren't good in sports and they're going to sign on with a contractor and they're going to be a carpenter or an electrician? Why don't we have a signing day for them so they feel pride in choosing that career? So it's those types of things that aren't partisan that I think we all want every child to succeed in whatever gift God has blessed them with. And that's the piece of it that I start talking about when I talk to people about education, even as a state house rep. And people are like, wow, you know, you really do care about people, which I'm like, okay, just because I'm Republican doesn't mean I don't care about people, but that's a side note. That's another show. But the truth is we want to make sure these kids excel no matter what, with the best guidance they can excel.
Absolutely.
So those are two things that aren't partisan that I think all of us can get on board with. And then the parental involvement piece of it. Everyone wants that. You know, we want good home life for kids that have parents or guardians that support them. And how do we foster that?
Absolutely. And exactly as you mentioned, like we shouldn't be that different or that divided. I get, and I'm guilty of this too, because I spend most of my time on the pendular extremes, on the crazy fringes of every side of the culture battles. And the average person, I mean, we want our kids to succeed. We all want a good, safe environment for them to grow up in. We want them to be honing the skills that we want them to be practically equipped and not politically indoctrinated. I would say on both sides, right? Because you have people that think, oh, well, this, you know, the new rainbow curriculum is a good thing, or the new CRT curriculum is a good thing because they agree with it. But they wouldn't agree if it was indoctrination from another, you know, perspective.
Yeah.
And so the ability to choose how your parents learn, for parents to be preeminently involved, to have a partnership with teachers. I mean, if not, like we're homeschooled, so we planted a flag in our ground, far from normal. Like we're gonna be the outliers no matter what. But every child deserves to have their needs met and their special their education taken very seriously. And so, I mean, the cesspool that our public schools have become, our kids all deserve better than that. And everyone should be able to agree on that, I love that idea in particular of celebrating trades, practical education with exactly the same fervor as we do for, you know, the typical four-year university. Every kid should be empowered to make those choices. They should be well prepared. And I've seen so many, you know, professors, people that teach at a high school and college level that are bemoaning the fact that kids are not ready, that they have to take remedial reading and math classes just to be able to function in a world where we need more and greater technological understanding. So the greatness of our people and the future of our society depends on the strength of our families and the skills of our children. That's not a debatable point. So anyone that cares enough to get involved at this level, to take maybe some slings and arrows because of the unfortunately partisan nature of basically everything today, I applaud you. I applaud everyone running for school board at this particular time, because it is a fraught time. And I'm continuing to pray for those elections. I will get engaged. There's a town hall that's happening. I was excited about it because I saw an actual paper on an actual bulletin board in our community. And so I took a picture of it with my cell phone so I would remember. I'm like, I'm going to be there. And they're going to live stream it. So we have technology out in Ogden too. And I'm greatly looking forward to that. I also know that school board members in our community have taken their mornings, at least two of them have taken their mornings down at the local coffee shop. And for 2 hours, basically every day from now until the election, they're just going to be there to meet with people and say, hey, if you want to hear more about me and about my campaign, we're going to be down, you know, at the one coffee shop in our town, and, you know, just come up, ask me questions. That's wonderful. That absolutely. I am confident that they care about our community because they're willing to make themselves that available. So I applaud candidates that are doing that hard work, that are, mm-hmm. you know, taking some attacks right now because they're willing to stand for truth. They're willing to stand for families and for parents too, for freedom. That can be a hard sell in today's age.
Yeah.
But that's where the tide turns. And that's where we say, you know, we're going to be different here. We're going to embrace excellence in our schools. We're going to empower parents and educators alike to give the best possible environment for our kids to really learn what they need to know, for them to love learning and figure out, you know, what God has called them to be and where their skills and their interests lie. That's a beautiful place. And we're going to make our schools an awesome place for kids again. We're going to make kids excited about learning again. And we're going to work together to make that happen. Mm. I see that. That's my prediction. Pollyanna, predicting politics over here. Samantha, any last words of encouragement towards parents, grandparents, just concerned citizens who really care about how to engage with the upcoming election?
It's so important that everyone votes, even if they don't have children in the district or they homeschool or they go to a private school, please go and vote in your local school board elections. It's so important to these people to have support and for them to get into office. So all I would say is please pay attention. like I said before, you can look up a Moms for Liberty chapter, but if you don't have that, get involved. I mean, you took a picture of your bulletin board. That's really all it takes. And now you're going to go learn. Mm-hmm. And so be engaged, be a good role model to those kids in your district that you're an engaged citizen and parent, and you want the best for them. So it's going to take the community to come together on those things. So please go vote. And good luck to all of our candidates out there.
Wonderful. Samantha Fett, thank you for your tireless work on behalf of parents and kids and your local community, our state of Iowa, and the cause for liberty. We appreciate you.
Thank you.
And as she said, it's time to go vote. Well, it will be shortly. You can check out who's running in your area. That's the first step, is to figure out who's on the ballot. Who are they? What do they stand for? And so that's a great place to get involved. Plus, everybody's on social media now. So it's not that hard to just say, okay, well, is this the Juanita Smith that is on the ballot? That, sure, let's find out who that is. Let's maybe, you know, meet for coffee, offer to buy them lunch maybe, or just like connect down the street at the local Casey's, which is what we have in our town, because that's what we do in Iowa. We go to Casey's. Mm-hmm. you know, give them a slice of breakfast pizza and talk with them about what they care, where they stand and what they care about. And it's not that hard, I think, to take our communities back in terms of believing in liberty and standing for a brighter future for our kids. They need to know right from wrong. Schools are not meant to be indoctrination centers. We're not supposed to experiment on our children. They deserve to be protected. They deserve to be loved and cared for, and they deserve to be well educated in the historic understandings of right and wrong, of truth and freedom, and nurturing kids up in the way they should go. When they're old, they will not depart from it. That's a promise. Thanks for listening to Faith Works Live. Share our conversation to get more people that you know motivated to make a difference in our upcoming elections. These matter. And until next time, we have a mission. So let's be about it: to love God, to serve people, and to live free.
Your beacon, Iowa's Hope 940.
How often do we spot the angels, or feel the unseen hand? Most times are tough, but going rough, like there never was a master plan. Those steadfast doors don't open, and you pray, but you don't understand. You've gotta hold fast the hope that's in you. Don't always trust your eyes. Sometimes it takes a long time to see it as a blessing in disguise. We live upon this dark surface, and God, He moves upon the deep. What is concealed will be revealed. There is no promise He won't keep. Still we're confused by the shadows. We're awake now, but we're half asleep. You gotta hold fast the hope that's in you. Don't always trust your eyes. Sometimes it takes a long time to see it as a blessing in disguise. Sometimes the dark can move our hearts to long for the light of the sun. And our ways don't become His ways until we are undone. Hold fast the hope. Takes a long time to see it as a blessing in disguise. And after you've been broken, you may not realize that you are grace to the brokenhearted. A blessing in you. You are a blessing in the sky.
Always on your beacon, Iowa's Hope 940.